Start. So on Wednesday we were arrived at this slide, and we were talking about examples of the usage of the flows in OpenFlow, and since there are many fields that can be used to identify packets belonging to a flow, there is a lot of flexibility in defining this abstraction. So according to the type of classification of the packets, a flow can be an end-to-end connection that is basically corresponding to a TCP or a UDP session, if you are very specific and the flow is identified by the source and destination ports and the source and destination IP address. Basically, we are using exactly the same combination of value that is used in the transport layers, so in TCP, to identify the sockets. Otherwise, you can just specify the destination IP address in the definition of the flow, and in this case, the switch behaves like a router, so basically forwarding the packets according to the destination IP address. Or we can invent other things. So let's say in this case it's the source IP address that is used. Here you also identify the specific device, because here there is also the MAC address, the source MAC address that is used. So it's the traffic that arise from that specific physical device, which in this case is a smartphone. Or you can play with the MPLS labels. MPLS is a possible implementation of the virtual circuit behavior over an IP network. So there are many possibilities, and the intelligence that is located in the controller or above the controller in terms of network applications will take the decision regarding what to of this possibility we want to use. The communication interface between the OpenFlow and the controller must be robust, and this is the place where the OpenFlow messages are exchanged. And in order to exchange these messages, there is the use of a secure channel, which is provided by TLS, which is the secure version of TCP, basically. OpenFlow is an interface, a point-to-point interface between the switch and the controller. Not necessarily this is coincident with the physical interface. So you can send OpenFlow messages on the internet, and they will get to the to the controller, from the switch to the controller, even traveling on a generic internet network. The transport layer security protocol that is used is the version, the secure version of TCP, implies also that when a connection is open, the two the switches and the switch and the controller identify each other by exchanging certificates. So there is also the authentication of the two terms host that are in communication. And the OpenFlow uses 6633 as a default port, so it's the well-known port number associated to OpenFlow, of course requiring a TCP connection. When the connection is set up, messages are transferred on this secure connection, and the status of the connection is periodically checked or can be checked by request upon a request of the controller. What happens when this connection fails? In the case the controller becomes disconnected from the switch, and the switch of course must react in some way, so to maintain the functionality in terms of layer 2 data plane functionality. So in the switch there is the configuration of the address of the controller, but usually another backup controller is also configured. So in case of lost communication with the main controller, automatically the switch tries to connect to the other controller. If also the connection with the backup controller fails, then the switch is isolated. So in order to maintain the correct behavior of the data plane, also in case when there is this momentary disconnection with the control plane, an emergency mode has been defined, and so the switches that enters the emergency mode because cannot connect with any OpenFlow controller take some actions that you can see here listed. So they reset all the counters of the connections. There is also the definition of emergency entries in the flow tables, so entries in the flow tables that are marked with a specific bits are declared as emergency entries. So in case of emergency mode, all the normal entries are deleted from the flow table except the emergency entries. And so the emergency entries remains there and continues can be used so that in any case packets that arrive in the switch are handled in some way. For example, an emergency entry may be a default router, so all the switch in absence of communication with the controller, the switch can be instructed to send all the traffic to a default router, another switch. And then when the connection with the controller is again provided, the emergency mode is abandoned, and the switch starts working in the normal mode. Then OpenFlow control traffic that arrives on the secure channel usually is not checked on the flow table, because the flow table is used only for transit traffic, transit packets. So the switch identify messages that are coming from the controller and treat them in a different way compared to the standard packets. So they are processed and don't enter into the flow table. There is an exception that can be done in the case when the controller sent the switch has sent a packet to the controller through the interface, the OpenFlow interface, and the controller processes the packet and replies to the switch, the controller can decide to return the packet to the switch, no? The original packet which was sent to the controller. So in that case, in some implementations, that packet can be matched against the flow tables. This is a scheme that shows the communication channel. So you can see that here there are the features of the secure connections. The port that is the default port that is 6633, as we said. And then the messages of OpenFlow or the OpenFlow protocol can be divided into three groups. One is the group of the asynchronous messages, and these are the messages generated by the switch in order to notify the controller special events. Now, like for example, packeting is the message that is used to send a packet to the controller. Error is the message to report error, and so on. Then there are the controller switch messages that basically are the instructions that the controller sends to the switch in order to configure the switch and the flow table in particular. And the symmetric messages are mainly those that are used to set up the connection. So there is the hello and echo request and reply to check the integrity of the connections. Vendor to notify to the controller which type of vendors produced the switch. So the messages that are sent from the controller to the switch are used to modify the flow tables and in particular to enter new entries in the flow table. So once the new entry is installed, is written in the flow table under the control of the controller, then a flow is instantiated, so all the packets that belong to that flow, that are matching with that specific set of values of the header, are then treated as specified in the action. So once the entry is written, the flow is created inside the switch, and then at a certain point the controller may also ask the switch to delete the flow if it wants to cancel that specific flow. There are two ways to instantiate a flow by the controller. One is the so-called reactive mode, the other one is proactive, and they are better clarified in this slide. So imagine that we have in this case the switch that with an empty flow table, initial empty flow table. At a certain time, the switch starts receiving on a specific port a packet, and this is the first packet that is coming on that port with that specific features. And here in particular, we have, for example, an IP address, the source address, and IP destination address. So since the packet does not match with any entry in the flow table, the switch will send this packet to the controller by using the OpenFlow channel. So the packet is encapsulated into an OpenFlow message, and it is sent to the controller. The controller takes the packet, process it, and according to the configuration or the policies of the network manager, may decide to instantiate a new flow. So it sends an instruction back together with the packet, and the new entry is created into the flow table. So in that specific packet then is returned to the switch, and the switch sends it to the correct output port. Now the flow is instantiated, so all the following packets of the same flow will go through the switch without any need to be sent to the controller. Okay? So this is the proactive, the reactive mode. Proactive is simpler. The controller at a certain time decides to instantiate a new flow in the switch. Okay. So in this case, it's a decision that is autonomously taken by the controller. So there is no need to send the first packet to the controller. All the packets of the flow will go through the switch without reaching the controller. The southbound interface is the layer that is responsible for interconnecting the controller with the data plane, so the different switches. And so we have explained the OpenFlow protocol, but this is not the only protocol that can be used. Okay. OpenFlow is mainly a control plane protocol. In fact, it is very similar to the routing protocols that are used in internet in terms of functionality. There are other functions that need to be performed, for example, the configuration of the switch or the monitoring of the switch. The configuration, OpenFlow is not able to make configurations of the switch. And so there are other protocols that can be used, and in particular the OS config protocol that you see there was defined together with OpenFlow protocol. So it's the configuration part of OpenFlow. Monitoring is also possible with OpenFlow because we have seen that the tables, the flow tables in the switches have that part that is for statistics, and so OpenFlow messages are able to tell the statistics, report the statistics to the controller, but sometimes it's not sufficient. So there are many protocols which have been defined for configuration and management. In the first one that was defined in the internet world is SNMP, is a protocol by ITF, and it is still used very much. For example, all the routers can interact by SNMP with the management part of the network. And it is simple, it's based on simple instructions get and set. However, it is based on the so-called management information-based model. And the MIB is a set of rules in order to specify exactly how each device can be configured. Okay. And it is quite rigid, so it requires that device is strictly compliant with the MIB model. Nowadays, SNMP is still used more for monitoring than for configuration. Okay, so to get information about the state of the routers, SNMP is very useful. CLI is a command line interface. Actually, it's not a specific protocol, but a type of interface that is the configuration interface of any equipment. It's called CLI because it implies that a human network manager sits there on the close to the equipment and start to open a command line interface to configure the machine. It is obviously used in a, can be used in a remotized way. However, there is the disadvantage that you can configure just one specific equipment at the time, and also some functions are can be quite different from one equipment to another. So there is no common standard. And CLI interfaces of Cisco are completely different from, much different from, for example, Juniper and so on. So other protocols more standardized were invented. For example, TL1 by Belfour is used especially in the United States, especially in the core network to configure to remotely configure the routers. And the other one, TR69, is used for the CPEs. The CPEs are customer premises equipment, those machines that interconnect, for example, a private network, like a network of a company, with the network of the operator, with the service provider. And so this management protocol was developed just for configuring in a remote way the CPEs using this auto configuration server. And this is an interesting step towards the innovation of SDN, because it was used, defined especially for the service providers. If the service providers has many customers, so maybe thousands of CPEs to configure, when some configuration parameter has to be changed, the command line interface is really a very ineffective solution. So by these automatic configuration servers and by the use of this protocol, the service provider can configure all the CPEs in one time. So this is a form of SDN, okay, even if limited for a specific task. There are more recent protocols that are now very much used in SDN. One is NetConf, that was standardized by EF, and it's quite important in SDN world, because it is based on an extensible markup language, XML, which is a way to represent in a file mode, in a file, all the parameters of the configuration parameters of a machine. Okay. More than that, since each machine may have a different set of configuration parameters, another way of let's say abstracting the single devices was defined, that is the Young model. Okay. So when NetConf is used for communication between the controller and the switch, the controller can understand which type of switch is talking about, and the switch automatically exports to the controller its Young model. So the controller not only knows what is the switch that is controlling, but also what are the parameters that can be configured. Okay. So by the Young model, the switch introduce itself to the controller, exposing the configuration parameters. And so this is very useful, because in this case the controller can become vendor independent. So you can control different switches of different vendors, and maybe also switches that are working with different interfaces, for example the optical switches, routers, and so on. Each one exposes a different Young model, and the controller is able to manage these differences. And then there is also this RPC that allows NetConf to instruct the switch, not only sending values of configuration parameters, but also installing procedures inside the switch. These RPC are procedures that the switch can have to run during its operating life. And for example, the controller may ask the switch to perform a local monitoring of some parameters, and if this parameter is above a certain threshold, then the switch will notify the controller. So in this case, the controller does not have to take all the values of that specific parameter all the time, which is not very efficient, but only if the parameter is above a certain threshold. And so, of course, the switch needs a software function to do this, the controller can install in the switch this software function using the remote procedure calls. NetConf is new, so it's just still under discussion, but is a new protocol. Not all the equipment supports NetConf, and so at a certain point, in order to ensure the usability of SDN also with legacy equipment, legacy routers, for example. Another two protocols are started to be used on the southbound interface, and they are BGP-LS, BGP link state, and PCP, which is Path Computation Element Protocol. Both they derive from the previous way of implementing the control plane, and in particular with the so-called GMPLS technology, that is a control plane implementation. And they are used for basically two functions: topology discovery and configuration of routes and paths in the data plane network, so installation of specific routes in the data plane network. And topology discovery is actually done using BGP when the controller has to discover external topology, so topology outside the network it is controlling. But since BGP routers are the routers that are on the edge, and the BGP routers have information about outside, the BGP routers can send this information to the SDN controller. But then the SDN controller can also acquire information about the internal topology, so internal of the network it is controlling, and this is by using BGP-LS, which is an extension of BGP, still under discussion, that is link state, so capable of reporting about the state of the links, similar to let's say OSPF. And then there is also PCP that is used in the case of topology discovery to get information about MPLS, so the configuration of MPLS label switched paths that are currently active on the network. On the other direction, the controller can use BGP or PCP in order to configure paths in the control network, and in particular BGP is to write the routing table of the routers under the control of the controller, and the PCP is to instantiate label switch paths that are connections using MPLS. So these are also used, and especially in the core network, so in the network that is the service providers, large service providers. Another interface is REST. Actually, REST is a more generic concept. It refers to interfaces that use the web servers in order to communicate. Okay? So they exploit when two applications are in communication by a REST interface, it means that they exploit HTTP or HTTPS to send messages between them. And the RESTful interface is an interface that is compliant to the REST model. Now it has become very popular because it's very simple to manage. You have just a few instructions: get, put, post, and delete. And by these instructions, you can send all the messages that are required. So it's flexible, easy, extendable. If you use HTTPS, you also have security features. So it's very much used. It can be used also on the northbound interface, but in this case also in particular in the southbound interface. And finally, there is also RESTConf, which is a combination of NetConf and REST, It's basically the version of NetConf that uses HTTP in order to communicate. And in this case, the Young model is actually translated into the so-called JSON or XML model. That is again a way to format data about configuration parameters. And these messages, these files are transferred over HTTP, and this is basically RESTconf. REST and RESTconf can be used also in the northbound interface, so, and actually are more used in the northbound than in the southbound. Northbound is the communication between the controller and the applications, that applications. So we have talked about the interface on a southbound. Now some words about the controller. So usually the controller is not a single software program, but it's a framework, a development framework, because it allows then who uses this framework to develop or customize the controller according to its own needs. And the controllers can be simple. For example, Nox, which was the first that has been used when OpenFlow was created. POX, which is the same but based on Python, and RIU, which is another version more recent. In particular, RIU will be the one that you probably will use for the project. These simple controllers are basically exposing to the interface, to the applications, the net applications, just the OpenFlow commands. So the OpenFlow commands that are used to communicate between the controller and the switches on the southbound interface are simply exposed to at the northbound interface, so that the network application can ask the controller to send a specific OpenFlow message to the switches. And so these simple controllers have not much than that. On the other hand, there are more complicated controllers which contains various extra features. So not only they are able to communicate with the switches on the southbound interface under the supervision of the applications, but they provide to the applications many other features that are useful to control the network. Sometimes controllers can also be used not only to control the network part, but also to manage computational resources, so especially if you have the combination of SDN and cloud implementation. And in this case, you have other modules, like, for example, the Flowvisor, which is used to partition the network to make it multi-tenant, so controllable by different users. And other modules. And in particular, you have modules for performing the topology discovery in an automatic way, maybe path computation, and so on. On the southbound interface, these evolved controllers are able to interact with switches that support different protocols on the southbound interface. So, for example, you have plugins for switches that are using OpenFlow, plugins that are using for switches that are using, let's say, BGP, LS, and PCP, the OpenFlow configuration protocol that is to manage the switches, and so on. There are two popular large controller projects. One is called Onos, and Onos that was created by OnLab, that once was independent, and now OnLab merged with ONF. So now Onos is by managed by ONF directly. If you see the architecture here, it's just a very high level scheme, but it's very complicated, and it is based also on the distribution of the core computation. So in ONOS, the controller is actually always implemented by a cluster of machines, and the minimum number of machines is three. So if you want a resilient ONOS implementation, you have to provide at least three computers that host the controller. And then you have so all the techniques, you know, that allows these machines to be always synchronized for the same vision of the network, and then many other features and the interface, northbound interface towards the applications. The other large project is called Open Daylight, and also in this case you have high complexity. In particular, there is this MD SAL intermediate layer, this model-driven service abstraction layer, which allows the controller to cooperate with many different devices using different protocols. So here you have OpenFlow, NetConf, BGP, PCP, and so on. And then the interface towards the applications is by RESTConf, so by using the HTTP version of NetConf to interface with the applications. Both these projects, ONOS and Open Daylight, are open source, so you have access to the code, and are very large, so contributed by many people that is working on the software. For example, ONOS it works with the so-called brigades. So each specific aspect of the software is carried out by a group of developers that form a brigade. And these projects were started with the contribution of many companies, so it's also large companies like AT&T, Huawei, so vendors, service providers, software developers, and so on. And here you can see all the interactions, and some companies participated in both projects, like for example Ericsson, Cisco, Intel, and NEC are both in Open Daylight and also ONOS, right? Because there is no real competition between no commercial market competition between the ONOS and Open Daylight, because they are open source. But there is a competition in the sense that then both of them tries to be deployed in the largest SDN implementation as possible. On the northbound interface, we say that we have the possibility of interfacing the controller with the network applications. So the controller is used like a network-wide operating system, and the applications, what they do, usually they are used for performing specific tasks according to the use case that you are adopting, so you need in your network, and in the general context they need to extract information about the network, so the status of the network and the topology, and on the other side to set in the controller specific behaviors or policies desired by the user of the controller and the administration of the network. So via the northbound interface, the network applications can access the underlying hardware. Sometimes you need to control specific parts of components of the switch, even at the hardware layer, by the network applications. So in this case, there is the need for the controller to expose directly to the network applications these specific parameters that can be also regarding the physical layer. then many applications are coexist and interact with each other over the controller, and they can use some services provided by the controller, like topology discovering, routing, and so on. Of course, obviously, the developer of the implementation has to understand only the APIs, so the northbound interface of the controller. Not necessarily he have to be expert on the specific implementation, software implementation of the controller. It's always defined in software, so unlike the southbound interface where you have standardized protocols, on the northbound interface you just have definition of APIs. And so this is also an issue because different controllers may expose different APIs. In principle, network applications should run on any type of controller, then in the real world it's not exactly so easy. But in any case, the controller has to expose information about the network state, and usually this is done by exposing an abstracted view, so a simplified graph of the network. And the network applications takes this simplified graph and do on the graph their calculations, like for example optimization of resources and so on. This general principle is that the network application should not have to handle directly the network state of the links and the resources, and so it is a responsibility of the controller to collect information about the state of the network so that the controller can expose this abstracted view to the applications. There is also, we talk about northbound interface, southbound interface, there is also the east-west interface, just to make it more amazing. And the east-west interface is the communication between different controllers. And it is used because, as I mentioned earlier, the controller is a single logical entity, but it is implemented by different machines. And so these machines communicate each other directly or maybe through the network. And it is very important that you have this communication between the machines because they have to maintain a consistent state of the controllers, of the different implementation of the controllers. So, because otherwise, if you don't have a synchronization, decisions that are taken on the switch can be inconsistent. There are several protocols also in this case to run these east and west interfaces. These protocols are mainly to solve the problem of synchronization. Typically, for example, this is what is used in ONOS, where you have at least three machines that are implementing the controller. By these protocols, there is always a leader that is elected by kind of majority voting system, and the leader is the one that then sends all the information to the other followers in order to keep synchronization. So, let's say the leading network state is contained into the leader, and then it is distributed to the other slaves. It may happen that one of the controllers is in a failure state. This is why you use this architecture. So in that case, these protocols that are running on the east-west interface start immediately to elect a new leader, and then another machine becomes the new leader, and so on. So in this way you can implement the controller in a very resilient way, even if there is a failure in one of the machines, the network is always under control. So on the southbound interface, we have mentioned that there are several protocols that can be used, and some controllers, as we have already shown, implement different support different subband interface protocols, like for example the legacy protocols, the BGP, LS, PCP, and the NetConf. OpenRelay was the first controller to support BGP, LS, and PCP. Okay? And in fact, it was very much appreciated by internet service providers because the open flow switches are just next to CAM and on the field already installed. Internet service providers usually have non-open flow equipment, so they, if they want to migrate towards the SDN control plane, they don't want to throw away their equipment on the data plane. So this is why BGPLS and PCP is important, and in particular BGPLS is supported by Cisco, and PCP is supported by Huawei, and they are both trying to push into ITF to extend the functionalities. So Cisco would like to have only BGPLS, Huawei would like to have only PCP. Okay. This is in a dynamic situation. NetConf is used, also supported by ONOS and OpenRelay, but there are some controllers that were developed just for NetConf, like for example the so-called Contrail, which is a product of Juniper. And it was developed to use NetConf and another protocol, this is XMPP, to create to manage the devices, in particular for the data center use case. SDN is a very interesting technology also to control the network internal to the data centers. So this is the list of, let's say, players that you may have in the SDN world and the interactions between them. You can read through it. And then here you have also some commercial products, like these ones that are from different vendors. You have the vendor, the type of implementation, if it is based on OpenFlow or other type of protocols. The name, like for example, Contrail, Juniper, and so on. And also the network applications that have been developed. This is the name of the controller. And this is all software, so it regards all the control plane. Here you have a list of open flow switches. This is a little bit out of date, but you can maybe find an update somewhere. And you can see that all the major vendors try to started to produce open flow switches. These products are hardware implementation of the open flow switches. There is also another way to implement the switches, that is this soft switch implementation. I mentioned it also by talking about routers. So you can implement the routers using a simple PC with equipped with several network interfaces and installing a software that emulates the router. And the same you can do with the OpenFlow switches. So OpenFlow switches, software implementation of OpenFlow switches are very useful, especially if you want to develop a controller or a network application and you want to test it without buying very expensive hardware equipment. And for example, the most popular implementation, software implementation of the OpenFlow switch is called OpenV switch. And so it open flow, open source implementation, and it is designed to work through the programmatic extensions with various protocols on the side of subband interface, like open flow, of course, but also the configuration protocols, in particular OVSDB, sorry, is the version of OpenFlow, OpenConfig, that is the configuration protocol of OpenFlow, that was developed especially for OpenVSwitch. There are many others of them, you can read through that. So let's now come to more specifically to the laboratory activity that you have to do in your projects. So I mentioned OpenVSwitch because you will see that you will use OpenVSwitches as a, implementation of the control plane. So basically, in order to, so since we have these virtualized switches, then we have also to implement a network to connect these switches, and there is a possibility of implementing again the network in a virtual environment using a mininet, which is a software tool that can emulate a network on a single computer. Mininet uses Lightwave processes. In the computer, you have virtual machines that are supported in Mininet, which run or emulate both host and switches. And everything it runs on the same PC. So you basically can create a network of OpenVSwitches and connect them with virtual links that using a mininet, so you can emulate a full network. And then you can also connect all these virtual switches to an OpenFlow controller that is implemented in another virtual machine in the same PC. All these emulated devices are always communicating between emulated virtual Ethernet links. So you have ports that are Ethernet ports that you can define and configure as they were real Ethernet ports. Actually, they are emulated Ethernet ports. So by Mininet, you can easily create your network that is used then to test the all the control plane that you have developed, and it is especially useful for SDN because Mininet supports OpenFlow. I think that current versions of Mininet supports also more recent versions of OpenFlow compared to OpenFlow version 1.0, but we will then better inspect into the possibilities and let you know. So what is the activity that you have to do in the project? First of all, you will use a simple controller. We tried also to investigate the possibility of using OpenDaylight, but which is little bit more nice than Ryu, has also a graphical interface, but the problem is that OpenDaylight is very heavy, so if you it's very big, so if you have to run in your PC the controller plus Mininet plus the instances of the virtual switches and so on, you need a very big machine. So probably you will use Ryu, which is simple but easy to use, and we have also already tested it last year. And Ryu is actually something that you download, so you don't have to create anything inside the Ryu controller, but you have to develop net applications that will run on the top of the Ryu controller, and in particular you will use Python because it's a simpler programming language that can be used in this case. It has a lot of nice libraries that are useful in for networking and matches very well with Ryu. So if you don't know Python, maybe you can start learning it a little bit. So what will you implement in terms of network applications? Since from this lesson on in the course, we will dedicate time to explain the different algorithms that can be implemented for doing a packet classification and the lookup into the IP tables for the IP address lookup. Basically, you will try to implement this algorithm by developing your software. So, in this complex architecture, what you will have to focus on will be the implementation of the same algorithm that we have covered in the course. And these algorithms are used to make, again, IP address lookup and packet classification. So when we need IP address lookup and packet classification, actually, if in the scheme that I presented you don't need to do this for all the packets, because once there is a flow instantiated in a switch, then there is already inside the switch the packet classification tool, that is the flow table, and so all the packets will cross the switch without any need of being processed inside the controller. But in the reactive instantiation of flows, you need to process the first packet of the flow. So this is where your network applications will come into play. When you will simulate the network, you will generate traffic, and the first packet of the flow, as soon as it reaches a switch, it will be sent to the controller. Then in the controller you will process the packet using your IP address classification or IP address lookup or packet classification algorithm. And then after processing the first packet, the controller will set up the flow. So the other packets will not reach the controller. So you need to set up a network in order to test these applications, and you will use Mininet so that you can develop the applications by your own and test it with your PC. And then we are working on setting up a physical test bed. So once your project is ready and you have already tested your applications using the emulated network, then you can come to the lab and we will test your control plane on a physical test bed that is made of a certain number of switches that are controlled by OpenFlow switches. The final goal would be to, first of all, obviously show that what you have done is working, and the second, as much as possible, try to compare the performance of different algorithms. So in the each group of each project team, each project group will be asked to implement not one algorithm, but maybe two or three, so that you can compare the performance of this algorithm. This is basically the commitment. And so in a real network you have what we have already described, that is when a packet is coming to the network, because it's the first packet of the flow. The packet is sent to the controller. What happens in the controller? In the controller, there should be a routing table. Let's say that we are considering for this example the case of IP address lookup. The routing table is written by the routing protocols of the network, for example, SPF. When the packet arrives to the switch, it is sent to the controller, and inside the controller performs a routing table lookup. Once the packet has been matched against the entries that are already in the routing table, the general routing table of the controller, then the controller will instruct the switch to set up the new flow. So the message will be sent, the flow message will be sent to the switch. The switch will set up the new flow, and then all the other packets of the flow will flow to the switch. Okay. So this is what would happen in a real network. The scenario for the project is exactly the same. The only difference is that you don't have to develop also control plane routing protocol algorithm, but you can prepare the table by manual entry according to the network, because the network that you are using, that is the emulated network with Mininet, is something that you know perfectly. You know the topology, so you know also the assignment of IP addresses, so you can compile the routing table inside the controller manually, maybe also static if you want. And so the rest is the same. So the first packet is sent to the controller, and the controller performs IP address lookup using the algorithm that you have implemented, and then the flow is created into the switch, and the rest of the packets will flow to the switch. Okay. So this is basically the schema of the project. There is a difference between what we did last year, because in the last year and also in the past, we completely skipped. We didn't require anything about flow instantiation to the switches. So in the last year projects, all the packets were sent to the controller. Each packet was processed, and the controller directly sent the packet to the destination. So there was no instantiation of flows. Okay. And in fact, by Mininet, you created the links, but the links were never used because traffic always went through the controller. So this year we would like to exploit the possibility of testing the control plane on the physical network of switches, and therefore we need also to learn how to instantiate the flows into the controllers, into the switches. So as I said, you will be required to focus on the implementation of the algorithm inside the controller, or actually on the top of the controller. This means that all the rest, so everything that is regards the managing of OpenFlow protocol and instantiation of flow tables and so on, will be provided to you. So we will do it. So just to simplify your work. And so we will give you already a skeleton of the network application, where you will just have to implement some of the functions. This is as we did also last year. We are still working on building this skeleton, so we will introduce it and explain to you later on. Okay. Obviously, you have to understand also how the skeleton works in order to be able to interact with the software. But you don't have to do everything from scratch by yourself. Questions about this? So now we can, next Wednesday, I will, before next Wednesday, I will send you a link to a doodle, so you can start also forming the teams. Okay. Usually the best number of members in each team is around 4. 5 is already a little bit large. 2 is not a very good team, but if you are at least, say, 3, good number. In some cases, for exceptional situations, for example, somebody who lives abroad and cannot attend the Politecnico frequently and so on, we can also accept individual projects. But I would prefer to form teams and work in teams. At the end of the project, when you are ready and the team is ready, you will have to hand in the project. So you will ask to make a presentation with slides and also live demo of your say, software. Now we have this new possibility that is the physical lab, so we will see how to manage in a logistic way the use of this physical lab. What else? All the members of the team will get the same grade, okay, for the project. And again, exceptions can happen. For example, one of the members never showed up or he refused to do anything, and so on. So in that case, I prefer maybe to split the team rather than giving differentiated grades. So because you are grown up, so you cannot get into the dynamics of each team. So this is basically all for the project. I will so send you the link for this the doodle for forming the groups. Next Wednesday we can start reviewing the groups, so if there are problems, people that is not in any group and so on, we can solve them. We are not ready to explain exactly say the skeleton, so we will do it later on. So from ne next Wednesday I will start also talking about the algorithm. Also because after you have formed the teams, I will propose a set of topics that are algorithm to implement. And again, the choice is the each team will have to set, to choose one topic, okay? And the choice is done in a, say, doodle way. But you must be know something about each topics in order to decide what you prefer. That is. Okay, I think that's all. We can close here.